And also VM Sharma, so both hand off to VM Sharma. But I would say this is nature, you know, so we just have to go along with that. Yeah.
You said we are visible to you?
Yes, very clear. Very clear.
And the banner behind us?
That is there's a little bit light on it, but it's visible to it's, some extent. It's a reflection of light, you know.
So what's the light?
Actually, we have projected it on the screen. That's why.
Yeah. It's okay. It's okay.
Now?
Yeah. Now it's clear. Now it's clear.
Because of the light.
Yeah, because of the light.
Okay.
Yeah.
How is life there in Norway nowadays?
I think the most of the things which are happening here are related to climate change, because it's quite mild compared to what we are used to, you know, in this type of the year. Usually there is, it's very cold, but nowadays it's plus 10 degrees. So
plus 10 degrees,
yes. Even in this time of the year, yeah.
It is also cold, at least for us. It's very cold, you know.
It's not getting cold, yeah.
It may be summer for you there. It's warm winter.
Yes. But actually, this is one of the few countries which is going to benefit from climate change. And the reason for that is because they will have more area to grow agriculture if they wish. Because it's a relatively large country. But,
Okay. Good afternoon to today's honorable guest speaker, Dr. Rajendra Bhasin. Respected Director Simpler, Dr. P.K. Singh, my dear colleagues from headquarters and all regional centers, and guests who have joined online, a very good afternoon to all of you. I, on behalf of Director Simpler, would like to welcome and thank Dr. Rajendra Bhasin, who has kindly consented to our request to deliver a lecture for our Platinum Jubilee celebration and enlighten us with his knowledge and experience. This center's and my association with Dr. Bhasin dates back to year 1989-1990. That is over 30 years of association. Rather, that was the time when rock mass transmission system were in vogue in the developed countries, and its application had just started gaining popularity in India. And our interaction were mostly related with rock mass transmission at that time. I would like to inform the audience that Dr. Bhasin was closely associated with Dr. Nick Barton, who has developed the Rock Mass Classification Index, Rock Mass Quality Index, or more popularly known as Q System. So without taking much more time, I request my colleague, Dr. R.D. Dwivedi, Senior Principal Scientist, to formally introduce Dr. Rajendra Bhasin.
Thank you, Dr. Saru. Today's speaker, Dr. Rajinder Kumar Bhasin, respected Director Simpler, Dr. P.K. Singh, and colleagues from Simpler Dhanbad and other our regional centers. Very good afternoon, everybody. Many of us may be acquainted with Dr. Bhasin because he has been attending all the seminars and conferences organized in India, at least which is related to rock engineering and tunneling. So, however, I will introduce him briefly today. I feel privileged to introduce him today. Dr. Rajendra Kumar Bhasin was born in 1963. He's as far as languages are concerned, he is very much fluent in English, Norwegian and Hindi languages, and also he understands Tamil and Korean maybe little. He completed his BSc degree in the year 1990 and masters in science with geotechnics in 1991 and PhD on topic and evolution of Norwegian method of tunneling principles for jointed Himalayan rocks in 1997 from University of Oslo. All the three degrees he has received from University of Oslo only. Currently, he is technical expert and regional manager Asia for engineering geology and rock mechanics at Norwegian Technical Geotechnical University, Institute NGI Oslo. He has been also disseminating his expert knowledge, and he is currently doing this thing disseminating knowledge and training to the students by holding responsibility as adjunct professor at Vietnam National University. He has more than 25 years of working experience and has been associated with various engineering projects in more than 22 countries around the world. His major fields of work relate to engineering geological mapping and geotechnical logging, static and dynamic analysis of slopes and underground structures, evolution of landslide hazards and mitigation measures, finite and distinct element modeling, estimation of rock supports for underground structures, advanced rock mechanics laboratory testing, ground penetrating radar, GPR, and in situ hydraulic stress measurements, and safety evolution of existing dams. He has more than 150 research papers in his credit. So, अंत में मैं हिमालय को प्रणाम करना चाहता हूँ, क्योंकि इस पंचकोट वर्ष के इस विशाल हिमालय को मेरा सादर प्रणाम इसलिए है कि अपार विशेषताओं के कारण संपूर्ण विश्व के शैल और सुरंगन से जुड़े भूगर्भ शास्त्रियों एवं अभियंताओं के अनुसंधान का लगातार केंद्र बना हुआ, और इसी के कारण हम लोगों का आज मिलन हो रहा है और डॉक्टर भसीन का लेक्चर हो रहा है. तो इसी वर्ड्स के साथ मैं डॉक्टर भसीन को आह्वान करता हूं कि वो अपना लेक्चर शुरू करें. धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर अनिल सरूप जी. आई रिकॉल अवर गुड एसोसिएशन सिंस 1980s, एंड यू हैव इंट्रोड्यूस्ड मी टू लॉट ऑफ द प्रोमिनेंट पीपल इन इंडिया, एंड इट्स बीन अ रियली रिवॉर्डिंग एक्सपीरियंस working with all of them, including yourself. So I will start with the with my presentation, and please let me know whether you can see it. One second. Here. No, sorry.
Just
one second. You can see the. Can you see the presentation? No.
Yes, your PowerPoint is visible. You can. Yes. It's we can see the. Yes. Yes.
It's okay. Oh, yeah. So very good afternoon. I'm very happy and honored to present this talk on the CSIR and CIMFR Platinum Jubilee celebrations. And I thank Dr. Swaroop for giving this opportunity to present a talk on the behavior of rock support in underground structures in seismic regions. And I acknowledge the inputs from my colleague, which is Dr. Madhi and Mr. Arnstein. So I will just have the pointer. Yes. Now, it's a very common notion among engineers that underground structures such as tunnels are invulnerable to earthquakes. And case studies show that the impact of earthquakes on tunnel lining can be significant, especially in weaker rocks, which I'll come back to in my presentation. And we know that the damage to tunnels greatly reduces with increased overburden, and this is due to the fact that there's reduced intensity of shaking experienced at depth. So that means that as the tunnels go deeper, then the damage decreases. Location of large caverns at shallow depth, for example, underground powerhouses, desilting chambers, and other structures, which I'll come back to, may be particularly adverse in terms of seismic design. So we really have to take care of such large structures which are at shallow depth because they are quite vulnerable. Now, I just always try to show this photograph from the Niigata Chetsu earthquake in Japan, where we have the derailment of the Shinkansen and the damaged tunnel in 2004. And we know now that new railway and road tunnels are currently being built in seismic regions of the world. And such a structure now, or a tunnel, is also being planned, this from Mumbai to Ahmedabad, where we will have a subsea tunnel, high speed. So these type of structures can be damaged, especially if they're not very deep. And this is just some figures showing the damages which have been caused in the tunnel. And here you can see the signs of fallen lining and concrete chunks, which are shown here. And you see the fallen concrete lining all around the arch. And in the photo on the right, here you can see what has come down also, these fallen concrete chunks which have come. And then there are shear cracks on sidewalls, protrusion into tunnels. So this tunnel was quite detailed, mapped, and it showed that earthquakes can have effect on tunnels. Now, when it comes to the behavior of tunnels, we know that it can be approximated to that of an elastic beam subjected to deformations imposed by the surrounding ground. And basically, three types of deformations express the response of underground structures to seismic conditions. And this is very well described by Owen and Shawl. So I would recommend anyone who is interested in the effect of seismicity on tunnels to please go through this publication. And the three types of deformations, basically they are axial compression and extension, longitudinal bending, ovaling, and racking. And this is what you can see here. So when you have a wave front coming here, we see that there's a compression of the tunnel section, which is shown here. You have compressions and tension in the tunnel section, but when the wave is here. And this is, again, this is shown that when you have a diagonally propagating waves, then you can have longitudinal bending. And down here, it shows how the tunnels can be racked, because this was the tunnel before the wave motion, and tunnel during the wave motion when it comes. And this is the ovaling of the tunnel when you have a shear wave front. So again, this is a very nice publication which describes the basic principles of how a structure can be affected by the propagating waves induced by earthquake. Now, what I did long back, and actually that was during the time when I was associated with Roorkee also. So we did 2D finite element analysis to investigate the effect of seismicity on tunnels, on tunnel lining in tunnels of different sizes. So which means that we had tunnels from 5 meter diameter to 10 to 15 to 20 meter diameter. So we wanted to investigate the effect of seismicity on this size of the tunnels. And both linearly elastic and elastic plastic analysis are performed. And we know that in the elastic analysis, the material surrounding the excavation cannot undergo progressive failure, as in the case of poor rock masses. That's the, you can see that this is the common notion in elastic analysis. In the plastic case, the material is defined as elastic, perfectly plastic, in which no brittle failure can occur. So we did these type of numerical investigations to understand some of the mechanisms at that time in underground structures. So this is what we see here, that when you have a static and dynamic loading in an elastic material, which means that which cannot undergo progressive failure, we see that there is actually not much difference in the maximum axial load on the lining. So this is a tunnel, 10 meter diameter tunnel. And then when we do static analysis, we can find out how much load is coming onto the lining of the tunnel. And here you see that the load. And when you apply a dynamic load, for example, in this case, a horizontal dynamic load, and we see that it's not much difference. Of course, there's a redistribution of stresses and displacements, but the load on the lining is not much changed. And the reason for that is because it's an elastic material. But if you do that in a plastic material, which can undergo failure, which means that, for example, in weak rocks, then we see that there is a higher axial forces on the lining when we perform the analysis with a dynamic load. And if I go back, this is the dynamic loading in plastic material, and this is also that. And here we see that there's a more pronounced loading on the lining when we have both the horizontal and the vertical components of that. So which shows that actually weak rocks are much more affected, because now we are doing the elastic perfectly plastic model. And this is just a summary of the results, where you can see here that here on the x-axis, we have the diameter of the tunnel from 5, 10, 15, 20 meters. And we have the maximum axial force on the tunnel lining, which is in meganewtons. And as I showed you earlier, just one simple example, that when you have the material, which if it's a competent rock mass or it's elastic, then there is not much difference in the maximum axial force on the lining, which you see here. But when you have a weak rock, then we see that this is the static analysis, which means that as the diameter of the tunnel increases, you have more load on the lining when the material is weak. And similarly, on the same case, if you apply earthquake loading, then the load increases even more. And I think this makes quite sense. This is actually something which some people have been saying, but it was not easy to prove in those early days. So I recall that Professor Bhamani saying in 1992, based on a number of tunnel cases in India where squeezing rock mass was encountered in the Himalayas, he advocated a heavier rock support system in tunnels as the tunnel dimension increases. And I think it was very wise of him to do that, because he saw that the rock mass was weak at that time, but he did it based on his observations. So there was basically no proof, but he said, no, the tunnel dimension does have a role to play. And these numerical studies confirm his recommendations for weak rock masses. For competent rock masses, the axial load on the lining does not increase significantly, as I showed you in the diagram, which is in line with the Q system. So that is where we have disagreed with Dr. Barton in many years, because his Q system says that the support pressure increases with the increases as the Q value goes down, but the dimension component is not there. But we believe that it does, and it was mentioned by Dr. Bhamani Singh, Professor Bhamani Singh, in 1992, and these cases show that yes, the dimensions do have a role to play. And this is a very good example of the project which I was fortunately involved in. I did carried out the mapping of this Norway's underground cavern. This cavern is 62 meters wide, 100 meters long, 27 meter high. And this cavern shows that the rock support is independent of the tunnel size, because when the rock is competent, you know. So here, the rock was not very weak. Of course, it was not of the excellent quality. It was fair to good quality rock mass, but we didn't apply so much rock support. As you see here, the rock support was 6 meter long bolts, 12 meter long bolts, and also we had shotcrete. And the diagram which you see on the right, it shows the excavation sequences of the tunnel. So 1, 2, 4, there's 3 and 4. So how it was constructed and how it was supported. So had the dimension of the opening played an important role for competent rock masses, then we should apply actually a lot of support, but no. So for competent rock masses, so we say that the dimension of the opening is independent of the rock support pressure. And this is just a photograph taken at the Olympic Stadium, so you can see how the rock mass quality, how does it look like. So this is from one of the adits of the tunnel in the Olympic Stadium. And this is the structure which has now been completed, where 30,000 people can actually come inside. You have seatings for only 6,000 people, but you can have large concerts, and practically the whole city where it's located can come inside. It's a huge, massive structure, and it's still ranked as the world's largest man-made underground object in the world. So this is still existence, and we have many visitors coming over from all over the world to look at the rock mass quality and try to understand how it was built without a pillar. So many people who come, they ask, where's the pillar? So we try to tell them, no, it's we don't have any pillars here. And it was methodologically and very nicely constructed, as I showed you the excavation sequences and how it was supported during the period of construction. So for weak rock mass conditions, the difference in axial force on the lining between the static and dynamic loading ranges from 15% to 44%, according to the numerical analysis, which I, simple numerical analysis, which I showed you earlier. And we know that the tunnel support strategy in seismic regions, when you use the Q, so we see that Q seismic is just as, it's like a thumb rule. Q seismic is equal to, roughly equal to half Q static. And this equation gives a 25% increase in rock support pressure in tunnel, which Dr. Barton in 1984 published. And the numerical results show, as I mentioned, showed you earlier, that the increase is between 15% to 44%, which is in line basically with what that thumb rule was, when the thumb rule was advocated in 1984. And here's the diagram which shows the rock mass quality on the x-axis and the rock support pressure. And I think many people from Roorkee and all over India, they have been using this diagram to find the support pressures. And we see that when you have a Q value of 2 and decrease it to half, to 1, so the seismic reduction of Q value to obtain 25% increase in support pressure. So the support pressure is increased by 25%, as you see here. But I would again say that we should use this diagram very carefully for weak rocks, because we know that the rock support pressure in weak rocks is basically dependent also on the dimension of the opening, which is not in this figure. And we also carried out some dynamic loading in competent rock masses with some joints, as you see here. So we introduced some joints. Earlier I showed you just the finite elements, and now we had introduced some joints. And we see that these joints, they work as stress collectors. And the maximum axial force on the lining occurs along the intersection points, so which means that the joints act as wave guides, accentuating damage to tunnel support. So if you have competent rock mass and you're doing this, so then we see that the joints work as stress collectors or wave guides, and where damage can occur. And this is quite similar to the wave guide action of parallel joints in an experiment which was carried out by Hughes and Morris in distinct element modeling, where he also showed that the parallel joints, when they are on the left-hand side, when they are subjected to underground shock, how they come out. But when you carry out this earthquake loading in weak rock masses, we see that the maximum axial forces does not necessarily occur along the intersection of the joints. It can occur in different areas, as you see here and here. So the recommendations for rock support in seismically active regions, we can say that the tunnel support and rock mass reinforcement strategies in seismically active regions should incorporate the use of flexible liners of fiber-reinforced shotcrete and systematic bolting to increase the modulus of the surrounding ground. And this is, I think, very important. And you can see here, this is an example of the reinforced ribs of shotcrete, which we have been using in Norway for over, I think, 25, 30 years. And this has now been implemented in India, and I will come back to that a little later. And this is how it looks like, these reinforced ribs of shotcrete, where you have the, in cross-section, where you have the 16 millimeter diameter rebar steels, and then you have the crossbar, and then you have the rock bolt. So if you go back to the other figure, so this is how it looks like here in the tunnel, and this is how it looks like in the cross-section when you take that. And these are some of the photos which show how they're installed. So you can see here that, again, you have these rebars placed. They are formed along the tunnel periphery. And then you have the crossbar. They're attached to the crossbar, which you can see here. And then before putting shotcrete, they are just doing a quick cleanup. So they just, because you want good adhesion of the shotcrete with the ground, so they do a quick spray of water, and then after that they shotcrete it, which you can see here, and this is the final product, which you can see, this is the finished product at the near the tunnel face. So these are what we call flexible rock support systems, and I think they are very useful also in the seismic regions to combat the effects of earthquake loading. And these are some of the comparison of various support elements. And on the left, you have the shielded experimental tunnel, which was described by Ward et al. In 1983, which you see here. And you can see here that this is the time and the displacement. And we see that the rock bolts and sprayed concrete arch, there's not much deformation if you do it quickly. And then if you have the rock bolts with wire mesh or something, then you see here you allow much more deformation. And circular steel ribs, they allow a lot of deformation because it takes time. And here you have also the stress reduction factor, which keeps on increasing because you're allowing the deformation to continue. And this figure is from Barton and Grimstad in 1994 on the update of the Q system, which also indicates that when the which support system is more appropriate. And we have also carried out instrumentation of this reinforced ribs of shotcrete, where you have the load cell right here for the ring stress, and then you have the strain gauge in the concrete, and then you also have the strain gauge for reinforcement bars, and also the load cell for rock load for the rock mass. So these type of instrumentations, I think they help you to calibrate your numerical model and to optimize the rock support, which we have been doing here in Norway. So in tunnel monitoring, we also have borehole extensometers above the tunnel, measurements of the rock mass pressure load against the rebars, ring pressure measurements, as I showed you in shotcrete ring at the backside of the rebars. And then we have axial tension measurements along the rebars and tension measurements in the shotcrete along the tunnel. So these are some of the tunnel monitoring systems which one has to perform. And then the results from these really help you to calibrate and optimize the rock support for in the same tunnel. And these are figures which I received from the Rail Vikas Nagam Limited, Mr. Sumit Jain, and they have successfully implemented and designed the same RRS in their tunnel. I think it is near Haridwar, which you see here. So, and here they have again, this is another photograph. So you can see here that in 2020, they implemented, they were here in Norway, a delegation from RVNL on training, and they visited some sites. So I was very pleased to see that they had implemented this in the correct format, and they had also attempted to monitor the load coming on these ribs. Unfortunately, the load was not so significant, but the implementation was carried out in a suitable way. And you can see here in the same tunnel, not very far from Roorkee, you can say it's in Haridwar, the first tunnel, and they have really done an excellent job in installing. So these diagrams are quite similar to the diagrams which we have, or photos we have from Norway. We had implemented this flexible rock support system and not the rigid support system. And these are cost-effective and time-saving rock support system. Of course, the contractors may not like this, but you know, such support systems allow you to efficiently construct the tunnel in a cost-effective manner. And as I mentioned earlier, that they have also carried out instrumentation where they have the load cell monitoring, and of course the load was insignificant. So now we are pursuing more research here in Norway, trying to optimize the RRS in tunnels, in underground structures, so that we do not oversupport. Because right now we know that these support systems work well, but are they over-designed? Are they under-designed? So for that, we're still carrying out research in this in this direction. And this is another example of the application of reinforced ribs of shotcrete in a low quality rock mass. So this is actually right in the center of Oslo. This is what we call the National Theatre Station. So you have a big underground station, train station, metro station here. And here you had actually very low overburden, and also the rock mass quality was not good. So in such cases, the reinforced ribs of shotcrete, what we have seen, can be very useful. So you can see here that station, it is about 966 meter long, new railway tunnel system, including a 250 meter long railway station with 21 meter span cross section. And the rock consists of shale and nodular limestones. And here the advanced lengths was just 2 to 3 meters, depending upon the rock mass quality. And the quality of the rock mass was quite extremely poor to poor. So it was not very good. And in such rock masses with large openings, as I mentioned, that RRS can be quite suitable. And here you can see the excavation sequences, where you had to excavate this track first, and then this track first, second. And then you took out the pillar, but at the same time you were supporting, and then these are the excavation sequences, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So as I mentioned here, this is the dimension of this railway station is about 20 meter from track 1 to track 2. And we're carrying out designing rock support through numerical techniques. And this is for one of the tunnels which I performed many, many years ago, where we found that the RRS is much more suitable as compared to cast concrete arches. So we compared the various support options and concluded in that, and there's a paper on that, that RRS is more suitable. And it was also, according to the contractor, the owner who was, and then the contractor, that was much more cost effective in relation to if they had used the cast concrete arches. And we're also familiar with this Tala powerhouse. This is in the Kingdom of Bhutan, where we were involved. And here you see that the powerhouse is 20 meter wide and 47.5 meter high. And this has experienced a number of issues And it's also not very far from the main central thrust. So I'll come back to that. And then here, a lot of instability has been experienced on the walls. And you can see that the walls are about 45 meter high and the powerhouse is 20 meter wide. This is a photograph of that. And here also we did a lot of continuum and discontinuum modeling. And we found that the maximum axial strength on the bolts on the walls and in the crown of the excavations, which were obtained here, were comparable to those which were carried out by the distinct element modeling. So there's a paper on that. And here, actually, 12 meter long bolts were installed. And we believe that they were insufficient considering the quality of the rock mass and also because of the seismic source, which is not very far from there. So the joints, which you see here in red, are those opened by movement according to the simulations carried out in finite element. And it appears that the bolts may be a bit too small and do not reach the excavation disturbed zone, which you see around here. So these are the bolts, which you can see, the blue ones. And we believe that that has also caused instability because the bolts were not long enough. And as I mentioned earlier, that the powerhouse is located here in Bhutan, and you see that the main central thrust is located on this side, not very far from there. And some of the facts about this powerhouse is that more than 5% of the bolts in the powerhouse have failed, and the walls of the cavern are continuing to converge, even though at a slow rate, 3 to 6 millimeters per year at that time. And plans have been made to stabilize this important structure. And the rock support system, as I mentioned earlier, consisted of this 26.5 millimeter diameter bolts and 12 meter long, fully grouted, tensioned Dividag bolts plus this. So this was the, and we believe that the bolt should have been longer. And open joints, this shows here that the open joints can reach distances of about 20 meter from the cavern wall. And here we have 12 meter long bolts. So this was also the modeling results which we had carried out at that time. And this is a diagram which shows the simulated convergence and displacements for different elevations. I showed you the cross-section of that. And these are at that cross-section, you have the crown, 525 meters elevation, 520. And we see here that the convergent displacement or the displacements in the walls can reach up to 1 meter under a dynamic loading. And the dynamic loading of 3 hertz wave. So the total displacement, which was after 6 seconds, and this was carried out by my colleague, who found that that in static conditions, the convergence may not be that much, but in case of dynamic loading, then you may have large convergences there. So the preliminary results from the simulations showed that if the movement was limited to less than 20 centimeter under static condition, it could largely exceed 1 meter in the case of an earthquake. And in this case, the peak ground acceleration was assumed to be 1 meter per square second for the study. And this case showed that cavern stability is highly vulnerable to earthquakes. So we really have to take precautions, especially when we're designing these large structures located at shallow depth. And this is another example of a very large tunnel, which is now had been approved by the Norwegian Parliament and where NGI has been involved over the years. It's called the Stad Ship Tunnel. It's a tunnel actually for ships. And one might think, why are they building these tunnels for ships? Well, the reason for that is, this is a map of Norway. And on the west coast of Norway, Norway is here, and I believe England is somewhere here. Yeah. And on the west coast of Norway, it's very windy. And over the years, many boats have capsized long back, so a lot of wood, because it's always very windy along here. So for the boats, for their safety, so they're planning to construct a tunnel somewhere around here, so that to avoid the high wind, so to avoid capsizing of these boats. And you can see here, this is just a photograph showing how windy it is. So for that purpose, they are designed this tunnel, and NGI was involved in that. And I had carried out some numerical simulations earlier to estimate the support requirements along with my colleague, Mr. Grimstad. And you see here that the width of that tunnel is about 36 meters and the height 37 meters. And then below the water, it's about 12 meters here. So this is the tunnel which has been approved and it's going to start construction next year. And you can see here, it's like a, one can say it's like a powerhouse, which is 1.7 kilometer long. And such structures, if they're located in seismic regions, then we really have to take care of that, as I showed you in the case of Thala powerhouse. And this is another photograph showing the entry and then the exit of that tunnel. So this is, as I mentioned, so this have, we have been involved and we carried out some numerical analysis. And this is the geology along the profile of the tunnel, where you have basically a gneissic rock with some shales. And as I mentioned again here earlier, it's about 1.7 kilometer long. And here we had carried out Q value estimations, and we have mapped the Q value. And based on that, we estimated what would be the best quality and likely quality. And then we had used the Q system diagram to find the rock support systems. And then we carried out numerical modeling. And here in that tunnel, so we see that we have applied 11 meter long bolts, and we see that it is still probably not enough. So we had carried out this, this is just a preliminary analysis at that time to estimate the cost of the tunnel. And then when we see that in order to penetrate the excavation disturbed zone or the yielded zone, so we need a bit longer bolts. And these are now 14 meter long bolts, which you see here. So the cross section of the tunnel is about 1,650 square meters. And we see that the maximum deformation in the walls, it's about 51 millimeter for a rock quality with Q is equal to 1. In good quality rock, the deformations obtained from these analysis was 16 millimeter. And the suggested rock support in bad rock conditions, we have suggested that there should be 15 meter long, 27 millimeter diameter bolts with a tensile capacity of 0.46 meganewton. And in some cases, we need to also install RRS. In good rock mass, 10 meter long bolts with tensile capacity should be enough. And we also carried out the same numerical modeling with some joints. And I think we will be continuing this once the contract is awarded to optimize this rock support even more. But these, as I mentioned here, these were very quick preliminary analysis which were carried out for the Norwegian Coast Guard Agency, which is the owner of the project. So some major conclusions from these studies which I have now presented is that the damage to tunnels greatly reduces with increased overburden due to the reduced intensity of depth. I did not present any cases where deep tunnels were modeled, but we have done that, for example, for cases in the Himalayas where the tunnels are located at below 600 to 800 meters depth, and we see that the effect of earthquake is little, and it is correct with the notion that with increased overburden, the damage is less. But location of large caverns at shallow depth, such objects may be particularly adverse in terms of seismic design, as some examples have shown here. And there are several more. You can read in the literature, there's a case study from Taiwan, from Mington Powerhouse, where such damages can occur in seismically prone areas. So with that, I thank you for your kind attention. Thanks.
Thank you, Raja, for the wonderful presentation. As always, it's very informative and technically very interesting. You always present like that. I just remember, after hearing your lecture, I was remembering that in the 1996 Kobe earthquake, they have done some studies out there, and they found that all the shallow structures related with the metro system out there, they got damaged. And they were mostly the railway stations, metro stations. And they were of bigger dimension as compared to the tunnels. And they got systematically damaged. Means they had their lining cracked, etc. Whereas the tunnel, which were at deeper depths, they did not find any cracks. Even they could not find any cracks. So your study confirms that large structures at shallow depth, and of course weaker rock ground, they have to be taken care of in advance for seismic conditions.
Yeah, I think Dr. Sarup, this is a very good point which you have raised. You know, many of the things which we know are quite logical, but you know, sometimes, you know, logic is there, okay, it's going to happen like this, but in order to prove it, you see, now we have the tools. These days we have so many programs, we have so many new tools, you know. So the purpose here was, you know, that whatever the notions we have, that somehow they have to be proved. And I think these simple, I didn't want to go into the details because we have a lot of other studies also, you know, concerning earthquake loads and things. But these notions, which you mentioned, are very relevant, and they have been proved, you know, in such cases where we have observed, as you have mentioned about the Kobe. And when we do the analysis, it's very simple analysis. You don't need to go into very, very deep. So that was the point of explaining, you know, so that the audience can understand that yes, we have to take care of these structures. So, yeah.
Any questions from anybody? Also, I could find your application of RRS also very interesting. RRS, you have related it with the stability related to seismic ground conditions. In fact, I find it very useful because it's very practical to install. As compared with lattice girder, it is, I think it's very easier. You don't need to have any specific size prepared in advance. You can prepare it as per your shape. You can bend it or mold it to the tunnel shape you require. And it's interesting to know that it is also helpful for seismic stability.
Yeah, that's also a good point, because the only thing which is required is good workmanship, you know. So I came to know that RVNL had some issues in the beginning, how to put it, you know, and how to frame it. But, you know, it's a matter of experience. And I think they became more and more confident. And as I showed you in some of the photographs which were sent by Mr. Sumit in RVNL, that it was really nice. And I'm very happy to know that some of these issues like RRS now, they are going to be put inside probably the Indian Bureau of Standards, you know. So because it has been implemented, of course, the contractors, Dr. Sarup, they may not be happy because, you know, they earn more money if they apply big steel ribs. But, you know, now with the tunnel construction rate happening at 100 kilometers a year in India, and I recall when I met you at that time and when we were communicating with Professor Bhavani Singh and your colleagues, you know, there were just few tunnels, you know, Tehri tunnels were very headrest tunnels. We were very looking into those. But with that increase, so I think we really have to go for efficient rock support systems and flexible, especially in light of the that these tunnels will be constructed in seismically prone areas, you know, which the Himalaya is.
Okay, thank you, Vandaji. Now I request my scientist in charge of this center, Dr. J.K. Manohar, to propose a vote of thanks.
So, good afternoon. Myself, Dr. J.K. Manohar, chief scientist and scientist in charge of SIMPAR We are very much thankful to Dr. Basheer, informative technical lecture on behavior of rock support in underground structures in seismic regions, with sharing his international experiences on the occasion of Platinum Jubilee of CSIR Singapore. We are also thankful to our respected director, Dr. P.K. Singh, for his initiative to conduct Platinum Jubilee lecture series and to take up the institute to newer heights with national and international recognitions. It is a proud moment for the institute that recently on 19th October, Stanford University has included 5 scientists of SIMFER, including Dr. Singh, in the list of top international scientists. This is a special recognition during Platinum Jubilee celebration of CSIR SIMFER. I am thankful to all the scientists and staff at SIMFER headquarters Dhanbad and its research centers at Bilaspur, Nagpur, Ranchi and Roorkee, especially my colleagues Dr. Swaroop and Dr. Dwivedi for their cooperation and support. I wish you a very happy Deepavali and prosperity with scientific achievements. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Raja. I think we should conclude now.
Okay, thank you.
Happy Diwali.
Happy Diwali. Thank you.
Happy Deepavali.